The lady of many firsts, a doyen in the field of education, a pedagogic pioneer, an art cognoscent, that is Vidya Shakti, Dr. Mrs. YGP, founder of PSVB Group of Schools. Happy birthday to the legend, who would have turned 95 today. Moments, hours, days, and years may come and go, but Mrs. YGP's educational legacy will go on forever in every PSVBian's heart. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. I'm Sheila Prakash, alumna PSVB Siriseri, and I'm privileged to be the MC for today's program. Prayer is the world's greatest wireless connection. Shreyas Sanjeev of Class 10C of PSVB Nungambakkam will now render the invocation. Achyutananta Govinda Namo Charana Vesha Jata Nashyanti Sakala Rogaha Satyam Satyam Vadamyaham Sharire Jarjari Bhute Vyadurasthe Kalevare Aushatam Janavitoyam Vaidyo Narayano Hari Narayano Hari. Birthdays are special, and 60th birthday even more special to every individual. In a land where opulent birthday celebrations have become common, here was an astute academician who decided to celebrate her birthday in an austerely beautiful manner where she turned 60, and thus was born the endowment lecture. As an intellectual giant, she believed that food for thought is better than the most delicious birthday cake. In the past 3 decades and more, luminaries from various fields, religious leaders, bureaucrats, writers, historians, and motivational speakers have shared the stage with the birthday lady and delivered the endowment lecture. More than 30 batches of the graduating class of 12 have been benefited by this birthday gift. Today, the 2021 batch is all set to listen to a young, inspiring speaker, Sri Dushyant Sridhar, on the topic, The Chosen One. Certainly, this batch is the chosen one to be a part of this hallowed forum and listen to the eloquence of this Indic speaker. May I now request alumna Aishwarya Anand of PSVB Nungambakkam to welcome the virtual gathering.
Let each one turn his gaze inward and regard himself with awe and wonder, with mystery and reverence. Let each one promulgate his own laws, his own theories. Let each one work his own influence, his own havoc, his own miracles, said a renowned philosopher. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha, and a very good morning to everyone present. Educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. And we are happy to be part of the glorious tradition begun by Mrs. YGP, the Shashtyaptamurthi Endowment Lecture, with her divine blessings. I am Aishwarya Anand, alumna of PSVB Nungambakkam, and I am extremely honoured to have been given the opportunity to deliver the welcome speech at this momentous occasion on our revered founder, Dr. Mrs. YGP's birth anniversary today. I extend a hearty welcome to renowned Indic speaker, writer and entrepreneur, Shri Dushyant Sridhar, our chief guest, who is here to illuminate us by delivering a lecture on the topic, The Chosen One, at the Srimati Vaiji Parthasarathi Shashtyaptamurthi Endowment Lecture 2020. Leaders don't force people to follow, they invite them on a journey. I bid a warm welcome to our guiding light and source of inspiration, Mrs. Sheila Rajendra, Dean and Director and Correspondent of the PSVB Group of Schools. As we embark on this journey of excellence today, I'm happy to welcome our distinguished pillars of support, the ever-encouraging and enterprising heads of the PSVB Group of Schools. The brain and driving force behind various innovative ventures of PSVB, I extend a hearty welcome to Mr. YG Rajendra, Management Representative of the PSVB Group of Schools. A warm welcome to all the dignitaries, special invitees and trustees of the school. Teachers are like candles. They consume themselves to light the way for other students. An exuberant welcome to all the teachers and members of the administrative staff. And of course, a cheery welcome to the students of Standard 9 to 12 who have joined us today on this significant occasion. Thank you.
Alumnus Siddharth Sanjay of PSVB KKNagar will now introduce the esteemed speaker to this gathering.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. It is with immense pride and pleasure that I introduce the chief guest for today, Shri Dushyant Sridhar, a BITS Pilani alumnus who worked in the corporate sector before finding his calling as a public speaker, upanyasakar and writer on topics related to Sanatana Dharma. Shri Dushyant Sridhar is an erudite scholar of many hats. He is one of the most sought after New Age exponents, rendering discourses in English and Tamil on the Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bhagavata, Vishnu Purana, Bhagavad Gita, Vishnu Sahasranamam and Divya Prabandha. He takes pride in connecting the youth of our country to our roots and heritage. Apart from delivering motivational lectures, he has accomplished the impressive feat of delivering over 3,000 discourses in 22 countries besides India. His discourses are interspersed with music, Harikatha, and interspersed with dance, Katha Nritya. As a choreographer, he has conceptualized and scripted for several dance productions. Shri Dushyant Sridhar is also known for organizing religious yatras to ancient Vishnu temples and has so far taken 2,000 people to 200 temples spanning 12 states and 6 countries in a 5-year period, covering a distance of 20,000 miles. He manages a charitable trust called Desiga Daya with a group of dedicated young volunteers. He has received awards like Young Achiever, 30 Under 30, Best Parliamentarian, Best Outgoing Student, and has received coveted titles like Sarva Kala Chudamani, Harikatha Bharati, Sollin Selvan, Bhagavata Baswan from various institutions of repute and excellence. We are honored to have you with us, sir.
The three most important aspects of a speech, lecture or talk are the speaker, the topic and the audience. When the speaker is an internationally acclaimed one, gifted with the power of science and ancient wisdom, and the topic is intriguing, the audience will naturally be filled with speculation on who the chosen one is. Let's listen to Sri Dushyant Sridhar and with spiritual bliss put an end to our guesses.
Namaskaram. I am very delighted to be a speaker for this endowment lecture. This endowment lecture, which commemorates one of the doyens in the field of education, in the field of Vidya, is Mrs. Y.G. Parthasarathy. I have had the fortune of having her in my audience for over 4 years in a row. Well, we can learn how to be a good artist, a performer from a plethora of people. But you barely get to see a role model of how to be a good listener. She was one. So with her blessings in abundance, just not on me, on the gurus who are imparting knowledge throughout this big brand of Padmasi Shadri institutions, and of course in abundance to all the students who are studying in various branches of Padmasi Shadri, my namaskaram and my obeisances to all the parents of such students as well. The topic chosen for this very short motivational talk is the chosen one. Who is the chosen one? Of course, God chooses every child of His and blesses them in abundance. But whether we like it or not, we do come across personalities who inspire us to do better. So there is one such personality whom we are going to look into our scriptures, who is going to be called the chosen one. Who is that chosen one? With not much of alpascha kalo bahavascha vighnaha, the time is very short, so instead of putting you all through more tests, The simple answer is Arjuna is whom I am going to look at. How is he the chosen one? Let's look at the way from his birth. Let's trace his journey from his birth. Pandu, the king who was on an exile in the forest with his wives, Kunti and Madri, was cursed of not producing children, of the inability that he may have in producing children through the normal process of the man and the woman coming together. Incidentally, Kunti was blessed with a boon of Durvasa Maharishi that she could invoke the grace of a deity of her choice and could get a child as a result. You can call it assisted reproduction. The techniques that are involved these days may not be, you cannot say the word in vitro, but they were assisted ways. So while she invoked Dharma Devata, she got Yudhishthira as a result. She invoked the all-pervading, very powerful wind, air, Vayu Devata, she got Bhima. And we all know that she invoked Indra, the king of all clouds, who blesses us with copious rains and thereby causes precipitation. She invoked his grace and got Indraputra, who is Arjuna as a result. Something very strange in Mahabharata happens while Vyasa describes this process. While Arjuna was born, Vyasa tells that the rishis who were performing penance in the forest, they all got together knowing this news and they wanted to have a glimpse of this newborn child. So they all came together and they had a witness. They witnessed the child's birth and they were super delighted to see this child. Comes the question, why? They could have been super delighted when Bhima was born. He was as powerful as Arjuna. So was Yudhishthira, who cared a lot for justice. Why special about Arjuna? Because he was a chosen one. Chosen one for what? Maybe his birth itself is the chosen one. So probably they wanted to see him. Let's see what unfolds after this. In his boyhood, while along with his brothers and the sons of Dhritarashtra, who were also his brothers, they were all taken to the tutelage of Dronacharya. It is believed that Drona, the guru, created a hermitage for all these sons of Dhritarashtra and Pandu to live and taught them. It was like a boarding school. And it is believed that the grama, the village where he is said to have taught them the various martial arts and various branches of knowledge, was Guru Gramam, which is today colloquially called Gurgaon and also rechristened as Gurugram. So there were various tests to understand which prince had what ability. Like for example, Bhima and on the other side Duryodhana were identified with extremely high muscular strength with which they could fight with the mace. So understanding one's strengths is very, very important. My cousin could be extremely good at programming, so he's a software engineer. Just because he is earning well, he has got into a dream job, it doesn't mean I have to become a software engineer. That's a case that has worked for him. I have to realize what are my strengths and weaknesses. Similarly, while archery was the art, Arjuna excelled at it. There is often, very often quoted the anecdote from Sri Mahabharata where he had a wooden bird that was attached or that was placed on the branch of a tree, and all of them were asked what they could see. Some said the ant, some said the leaves, some said the branches, some said the a tree, but Arjuna took shot at the bird and especially at its eye. This spoke a lot about his focus. He knew what his area of expertise was, or what his area of expertise was likely to become, and what his target was, and what was specific in that target. So Dronacharya was verily impressed with Arjuna's pointing out of his target. He thought archery was that which was suited for Arjuna. So much so that later we say, Yatra partho dhanurdharaha. If there is one person who is the best archer in the world, it is Arjuna. As his journey in education under Dronacharya continued, there is one instance where Dronacharya, despite being one of the best teachers, was still partial. It is very, very tough for a teacher in whichever field they are, whether in the spiritual, religious, or the modern education field, to get rid of partiality. Prejudice also becomes a part of a teacher. The teacher may not want it, may not like it, but that's human tendency. Likes or dislikes for no reason. That's prejudice, right? So Dronacharya, he sought a special permission where this tutelage, this ashrama, this hermitage was meant to teach only the sons of Dhritarashtra and Pandu. He got a special permission for his son Ashwatthama to also study. Ashwatthama was his only son. So to impart that extra knowledge, so if 90% was given to them, the remaining 10%, the extra 10%, he wanted to give it to Ashwatthama. So he would give all these students who were learning under him big pots and would tell them, go to the nearby lake, fetch water and come, all of you. So all the 100 plus the 5 would run. But these pots were different. All of these pots had a very, very thin mouth, a large base. So if you have to put them inside water, so the air has to first get out and then the water has to come. So the water has to replace the air. But the opening to the pot, the jug, was very, very narrow. So if it would take normally say 20 seconds for a pot to get filled with a larger mouth, this would take about 40 or 50 seconds. So all these 100 plus the 5, the sons of Dhritarashtra and the sons of Pandu, were given with a thin opening, narrow opening. Whereas one single pot with a large mouth was used to be given to Ashwatthama, his son. So he thought Ashwatthama would also run with these boys, go to the waters, fetch, but he would return 30 seconds in advance because they would take 50, he would take 20. So there is a gap of 30 seconds. So every day, if this is the case, in the 30 seconds, I will teach him an extra astram so that I equip my son better. But it did so happen that Ashwatthama would come running along with Arjuna to Drona. Drona would ask, how did you fill, Arjuna, with such a thin opening, narrow opening? Arjuna used to say that I have seen in certain manuscripts of yours about Varuna Mantra, which when recited with devotion will help fetch water in the very place I am. I didn't go to the lake waters. I stood in this place, got it fetched, and so I am able to compete with your son. Drona was amazed at Arjuna's ability to use knowledge suitably so that he could acquire better and more knowledge. Some may think that these are shortcuts. Yes, could be. But as long as the purpose is legitimate, Krishna does that in Mahabharata, right? He tells Yudhishthira, you may be wondering why I'm making a Shikhandi stand to vanquish Bhishma in the battle. Why I'm making you say Ashwatthamo, Kunjaraha, Hataha to vanquish Drona in the battle. At that point in time, it may seem wrong, but they have committed such wrongs in the past. And ultimately, they too desire a good, a righteous king like you, Yudhishthira, to sit on the throne of Hastinapura. So looking at that as the destination, these steps may seem like shortcuts, Krishna tells. But Arjuna's aim was to become the best in archery, not to be one amongst the archers, the best. So Drona said, you are just not matching my son, you're exceeding my son, because my son is coming to me with the pot that I gave. It has an advantage, but you had a disadvantage. You converted this challenge into an opportunity by using Varuna Mantra and you're coming back to me. Arjuna, you're the chosen one. So he was a chosen student. Drona was very proud of Arjuna. Yes, he was proud of other students as well. But it's natural for a teacher when you find something very unique in your student to get. That's very natural. Of course, it shouldn't turn into a prejudice. But the special liking does exist. He was a chosen one there too. Later, when Guru Dakshina was sought by Dronacharya, what was the Guru Dakshina? It was not a region, nor a palace, not hordes of wealth, but it was to vanquish Drupada, who was the closest friend of Dronacharya in a battle. Because though they were good friends, Dronacharya happened to be insulted and humiliated in the court of Drupada. So he then vowed that I shall train my students in such a fashion, with such a vigor, that one day one of my students will vanquish you in the battle, Drupada, to say that I need not have to come to the war field to vanquish you, my student is enough. So while the Kauravas, the sons of Dhritarashtra, went, they thought they were 100 in number. See, generally we believe in this world, the more you are, you can always show your power. No, you could be very little, but with the dedication and sincerity in you, you can win over the higher number. So Kauravas went, the sons of Dhritarashtra, the Dhritarashtras went, they were terribly defeated. To get them out from the clutches of Drupada, the Pandavas had to go, but that is where Arjuna strategized. He said, see, in this battle, instead of mace and spear, let's use archery as the mode of fighting. So I will take care of fighting with Drupada. But we have to be led by a very good leader. That's our eldest, the eldest of our brothers, who is Yudhishthira. So I will be standing besides Yudhishthira. Yudhishthira will not fight, because the moment you catch the leader of the opposite party, then it means that the party is defeated. So I will stand next to Yudhishthira, being his guardian, as well as I shall fight Drupada. On the other hand, there are horses that are leading our chariot. The horses shouldn't be killed. So Bhima, you walk in front of the horses to protect them. The wheels that are supporting our chariot, the two wheels, should not be broken. Then we won't have a chariot to fight on. So we should have Nakula and Sahadeva protecting the wheels, Bhima protecting the horses, and I protecting the brother Yudhishthira, as well as fighting Drupada. Just five in number. In a minute, he was able to vanquish Drupada and pull him to Dronacharya. And Dronacharya said, as a student and as my students, you have given me Guru Dakshina. I bless you. Of course, what happened next was Drupada wanted a son who could kill Dronacharya, but he developed a wish. He said, if at all I have a girl, a daughter, she must marry this Arjuna, because I just can't find anybody as valorous and as strong and as astute as Arjuna. So as a result, he had Panchali Kumari, Chapi Panchali, Vedi Madhya Samuttita, Shubhaga Darshaniyangi, Vedi Madhya Manorama. She was extremely beautiful, and this entire Chakravyuha was aimed at getting the best archer, and as a result, Arjuna came. He looked into the reflections of the waters for the reflection of the fish that was revolving above, hit at its eye, just one shot, and was able to prove it was just a cakewalk for him. So he was again the chosen one to marry Draupadi. What happened next of her marrying all the five Pandavas was as a result of Kunti's interpretation and Yudhishthira's reinterpretation and Krishna's assurance. All that is not our concern now. So right from his birth to his tutelage to his marriage, he was a chosen one. He was also the chosen one for a curse. While he had to go get missiles, first he sought the blessings of Lord Shiva to get the Pashupatastram. Then he went to Amaravati to get the missiles from Indra, his biological father. And then while he stayed there, it is said that he was asked to learn proper dancing as well, because a Kshatriya learning dancing was very unique in those days, was never heard of. Not that they shouldn't learn, the best of the dancers is the man who is Lord Shiva as Nataraja, but nevertheless it was very strange for somebody asking Arjuna, the best of the archers, to learn dancing. Of course he learned from Uruvashi, Uru Jate, the one who was born of the Lord's thigh, who was extremely beautiful, was Uruvashi. Stri Ratna Karanam Upapatta Tritiya Varanam Daityendra Veerashayanam Daitopadhanam, tells a medieval poet preceptor called Vedanta Deshika. So here we have him learning dance, and at the end of which Urvashi said, if you have to give me any Dakshina, please marry me. You know what Arjuna said? Arjuna said, see, you have expressed your love. That's of course your freedom. But please do understand, I too reciprocate that love, but in a different way. Because you were married to one of my ancestors called Pururavas, and you had a son as a result. So you fall under my ancestor's lineage. You are a motherly figure to me. So I can't marry you. The moment she heard these words, she cursed. It's because of you being very masculine and best of the archers, you're thinking that you just can't marry me. I curse that you should be turned into a woman for a year. So as a combination, as a eunuch, he existed for 1 year as Brihannala in the year of incognito called Ajnatavasam. So even this curse was a unique one. So he was the chosen one to get this unique curse. And later, during the days of Mahabharatam, there was a tug of war to understand who's going to join which party. So there were two large parties. So they wanted allies. So various kings, because of gratitude, had to join Dhritarashtra. So he started getting large retinues. They were already 100 in number. They had large armies. But to get help from Krishna, Shakuni dispatched Duryodhana to Dwaraka, and so did Yudhishthira dispatch his younger brother Arjuna to Dwaraka. Both of them were related to Krishna, because Krishna's father Vasudeva had a sister called Kunti, who was Pritha. Kunti's son was Partha or Arjuna. So to Arjuna, Krishna was his own uncle's son, and for Krishna, Arjuna was his aunt's son. So they were related. And the other relationship was, Arjuna was married to Krishna's sister Subhadra. On the other hand, Krishna's son Shambha was married to Duryodhana's daughter. So they were sambandhis. So if somebody would come asking for help, Krishna was obliged to help both of them. That is when, reaching Krishna's antapuram, harem first, Duryodhana happens to sit near Krishna's, the place where Krishna had placed his head while he was resting. On the other hand, Arjuna comes and sits at his feet. So while Krishna wakes up, he sees Partha, Arjuna first. He said, Arjuna, you're welcome. So what do you want? By then, Duryodhana got really angry. He said, I was the first one to come. Well, Duryodhana, you were the first one to come. I agree. But you were seated at a place where I couldn't notice you. So the first one whom I saw was Arjuna. So I should ask what he wants first. No, I was the first one who came. No, even if you were the first one to come and later I had noticed you first and then Arjuna, even then I would ask Arjuna first, because Dharma Shastram tells when the elder and the younger one exists, the choice has to be given to the younger one. So I shall ask Arjuna first. What do you want, Arjuna? Do you want the large retinue with the cavalry, the elephants, the horses, the soldiers called Narayani, the Sainyam? Or do you want the person called Krishna, who has vowed not to lift any of his weapons in this yuddham? Do you want this helpless Krishna, or you want this large army? Arjuna said, I want only Krishna. Whether you fight or not doesn't matter to me. I want you to be with me, Krishna. You are my friend. You have to be with me. And Duryodhana was super happy. He thought that he had taken the weaker point, and he said, no, I'll take the army and leave. So again, Arjuna was the chosen one to have come and asked. So understanding the situation around, gauging the situation around, understanding what my strengths and weaknesses are, understanding what I need, what talent I need, what skills should I hone, is a beautiful art which we should all learn. Just not as a speaker, not as a listener, not as a teacher, not as a student, which all of us should learn. So Arjuna became the chosen one there too. Then came the final moment where the yuddham had to begin. Dharma kshetre kurukshetre samaveta yuyutsavaha mamaka pandavaschaiva kimakurvata sanjaya. Hey Sanjaya, please tell me what's happening between the sons of Pandu and that of mine. Dhritarashtra asks, since Sanjaya was blessed by Vedavyasa to see things which were happening far away, he was able to narrate what was happening. He did say that people started blowing their coaches, and that is when people started blowing, Arjuna said, I just can't fight my uncle, my nephew, my brothers, my guru, my grandfather. Krishna, please keep the ratham in the middle of the ground. I just want to see both sides. See, both sides are related to me. They are related to me by blood, by flesh. Krishna said, see, all these days while I went as a messenger, I said, don't fight. Let's seek peace. All of you brothers, and you especially, wanted to fight. Finally, you end up on the war field, and now you realize I am A positive, he is A positive, I am A positive, he is A positive. Why do you speak about blood groups and relationship now when you are ought to fight? Arjuna, it's now time for you to fight and prove your point, prove that your side has righteousness. Krishna could have stopped there. But now, in his excitement to speak, now that Arjuna has asked a question, he started speaking about what value does karma, karma yoga, the path of performing karma, hold? What value does the path of the knowledge accrued as a result of karma, jnana yoga, hold? What does the path which speaks about utmost devotion to both karma yoga and jnana yoga, which is ashtanga yoga, hold, called bhakti yoga? Well, his question was, should I fight them or not? They are related to me. Krishna could have just said, go fight. But he was of the opinion that in all his avatars, he just was present, vanquished, established righteousness and went. Paritranaya sadhuna vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. But he had never ventured into explaining the quintessence of dharma shastras. What are in the four Vedas? Rig, Yajuhu, Sama, Atharvanam. Where there is karma kandam and jnana kandam. What is the quintessence of the four sections in every Veda? Brahmanam, Aranyakam, Samhita, Upanishad. What is the quintessence of reading the Vedanga, Siksha, Jyotisham, Kalpam, Niruktam, Chandas? What is the essence of reading the Upangas? What is the essence of reading Dharma Shastras? What is the essence of reading Itihasas and Puranas? Krishna had to bring the quintessence of the mammoth level of scriptures that we have into one essence. And he chose Krishna avataram for that. And the place where he chose was Dharma Kshetra, Kurukshetra. And the person whom he chose as a recipient to receive that quintessential knowledge was Arjuna. Why? Because he had won over sleep. Guda Kechaha. Gudaka is just not the normal sleep. Lethargy. When we acquire knowledge, shouldn't we be able to relish that knowledge? Shouldn't we have the ability to see through that knowledge and see how useful it can be rather than just memorizing it and reproducing it and forgetting it? So all this is because of the lethargy which we have. Lethargy, of course, tiredness, fatigue leads us to sleep. See, at one over sleep, Gudakeshaha. And who's Krishna? Hrishikeshaha, the one who had won over senses. He was explaining to the one who had won over sleep. This is the quintessence of knowledge. So Arjuna again becomes the chosen one. Again becomes the chosen one for the quintessential Upanishadic knowledge. Sarvopanishado gavaha dugdha gopalanandanaha parthovatsaha sudhir bhokta dugdham gita amritam mahat. So even to explain the quintessence of Upanishads, the chosen one was Arjuna. Later, after Mahabharata Yuddham, when people retired to their original places and Arjuna wanted to accompany Krishna to Dwaraka, there was a person whose newborn children were getting vanished, they were getting lost. And Arjuna said, in such a beautiful city of Dwaraka, I will never let the stain hamper my friend Krishna's administration. I shall protect your next child. And as he wanted to create a huge mesh of astras around the child again disappeared, the newborn child. So while people were waiting for Arjuna to fall into fire, because he said, if I can protect the child, I will fall into fire. That is when Krishna said, do not worry, just hold my hand, sit on my chariot. And it is said in Bhagavatam, it may seem very, very shocking and even surprising to us. The entire chariot along with Arjuna, along with the charioteer, the horses, they all ventured into the Karya Vaikuntham, an abode of the Lord. They went and saw the missing children. Then he took the children back and gave them to the Brahmana who had lost the children. Now comes the question. Why was he chosen again? Because Arjuna as a character, of course, he may have a lot of fallacies, that which we aren't seeing, because if fallacies were a list, then probably each of us will be the first to get into it. So despite having a lot of other weaknesses, the strengths of Arjuna was, he knew what he was doing. Isn't that very simple? He knew what he was doing. He knew he was good at archery. He knew he had the skills in him. He knew how to hone those skills and he knew what he was doing. He knew who his real friend was. He chose his friend over other things in life. A good friendship. In Tamil, there is a beautiful verse. தனம் தரும் கல்வி தரும் ஒரு நாளும் தளர்வறியா மனம் தரும் தெய்வ வடிவும் தரும் நெஞ்சில் வஞ்சமில்லா இனம் தரும் tells the Tamil poet. We should have friends around. They don't have to be high in number, 100 friends, no. Just 2 in number, but they should be people who think good for you. நெஞ்சில் வஞ்சமில்லா இனம் தரும். So here we have Arjuna who chose the right friend, who saw friendship in divinity, who's Krishna. He had great attachment and bhakti towards the guru who imparted knowledge, who's Dronacharya. So great bhakti for Acharya, Dronacharya. Great value for friendship towards Krishna. Complete belief in his skill set and in the area where he chose, which is Dhanurvidya, archery. And great respect for women around him. An excellent example is Urvashi. He could have married her. He didn't. He said, I have to respect womanhood. You belong to my ancestors. I can't marry you. So all these made him the chosen one to receive knowledge. Isn't knowledge what we are aspiring for? Isn't knowledge what will make this world a better place? Where peace is what we all want. We want each of us to respect the other person. Irrespective of whichever caste, creed, nationality, race, gender, orientation that person belongs to. Wouldn't this mutual respect, tolerance make this world a better place? Wouldn't it be a better place where each religion acknowledges, understands and respects the other religion? Rather than saying that my way is the only way, rather than saying that my worship is the only form of worship, why can't we mutually respect and say that all religions lead to something good? Why can't we say that every religion aspires for peace? Let every religion not tolerate each other, mutually respect each other. Let us move from tolerance to mutual respect. I think all this will create a very, very organic and a very symbiotic society. And this will create a lot of peace and tranquility amongst us. And of course, to my dear friends of various grades, you have a very, very beautiful path in front of you. Generally, people say, a child is a ball of clay, we can mold it. Why should they mold you? Each of us is like a sapling. People have to just be conducive enough to our growth. We will grow by ourselves. So with this, from my side, of course, I can say that you have had a great doyen who is going to wish you from wherever she is. You've got a wonderful set of teachers, a committee, a board, and wonderful parents who are blessing you eternally. So with these blessings, I'm sure your futures look very, very, very colorful and bright and vibrant. I'm very thankful for giving me this opportunity to speak. On a side note, if you have your parents and grandparents who can understand simple Tamil, they don't have to read and write. Even if they can understand simple Tamil and they are inclined to understanding bhakti literature in Tamil, and if they are inclined to learning Nalayara Divya Prabandham, especially not of its recitation, but to understand the meaning, what has gone into the minds of the Alvars while composing these verses, what has gone into the minds of the Alvars while compiling these verses, what has gone into the minds of the commentators, the Vyakhyanakartas who have given us beautiful commentaries on these works, and what is about the beautiful temples, the Divyadeshams on which they have sung. I have launched a very, very simple and a very maiden initiative called Abhinava E Patashala, contemporary way of Patashala, Guru Sishya Parampara. And this is E Patashala, Abhinava E Patashala. So I have launched a course called as Prabandha Sara Bodhani. The compilation of the Alvar hymns, Pasurams, is called Nalayara Divya Prabandham. But it's a big work, 4000 verses. I am going to explain the quintessence of taking up select Pasurams from all the Prabandhams of the Alvars with the commentaries, and I'm going to explain it in simple Tamil. So this will be given in the form of 24 e-lessons, 90 minutes each e-lesson, across Saturdays and Sundays from January. Now the registrations are open. If your parents or if your grandparents, of course, if you want a change from your regular academics and you want to engage that 1.5 hours on Saturdays and Sundays, and if you can understand simple Tamil, So there's no age bar, there's no religion bar, there's no caste bar, there's no discrimination, creed, nationality. So we don't ask any of these details. So if you have, of course, less than 10 years or if you have your cousins, they may not find this course very interesting. It'll be tough for them. Otherwise, anybody can join. So if you have people who will be interested in Prabandha Sara Bodhani, my earnest request is to let them know from your side that there is a course and they're free to join. If you have grandparents who are interested, help them out in registration and they will be very, very happy to listen from where they are seated comfortably. So to know more details, please go to www.desikadaya.org/AEP. Namaskaram.
பக்தி மார்க்கத்துக்கு வித்திட்டது யார்? தமிழ் மொழியை வளர்த்தது யார்? நாம் கற்க வேண்டியது யாது? இவ்வனைத்துக்கும் விடை ஆழ்வார்களும் அவர்கள் கொடுத்த திவ்ய பிரபந்தமுமே ஆகும். ஆழ்வார்களின் வாழ்க்கை வரலாறும் அவர்கள் அருளி செய்த பாசுரங்களில் உள்ள அழகும் அந்த அழகுக்கு மேலும் அழகு சேர்க்கும் வியாக்கியானங்களும் அந்த பாசுரங்களால் பொலிவு பெறும் திவ்ய தேசங்களும் இவ்வனைத்தையும் ஒருங்கிணைக்கும் வகையே அபினவ இ பாடசாலா வழங்கும் பிரபந்த சாரபோதனி A comprehensive e-course. மேலும் விவரங்களுக்கு kindly visit www.desikadaya.org/AEP. வாரி பக்தி தமிழில்
Thank you, sir. It is such an epic coincidence that the DJC logo, designed by an executive trustee, depicts the theme of the endowment lecture. I'm sure all of us will get this analogy correct. Lord Krishna is to Arjuna as Dr. Mrs. Parthasarathy is to P.S. Vibhayan. She, as a charioteer, has given the Gita of AIR. The Balabhavan Educational Trust awards the endowment scholarship every year on this auspicious occasion. This year, the recipients are Master Anantajit Badri from 12C, PSVB Nungambakkam, Master S. Kavin from 8A, T. Nagar Branch, Ms. R. K. Kanishka, 3J from PSVB KK Nagar, Ms. S. Samiksha, 12E1, and Ms. B. Kokilavani, 8A1, PSVB Siriseri. Congratulations, students. May I now call upon the Dean and Director, Mrs. Sheila Rajendra, to share her thoughts on this propitious occasion. Mrs. Sheila Rajendra, the guardian angel of PSVB, who champions the cause of elves in the curriculum, has made us realize that it is the elves that have given the strength to transform challenges into opportunities. Over to you, ma'am.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Pranams to our Guru, Dr. Mrs. Vaichipi. This is the second year that the endowment lecture is taking place without the birthday lady around. When someone we love becomes a memory, that memory turns into a treasure. Each year since 1985, the endowment lectures have become treasure trove of invaluable tips for the youngsters. We are fortunate that Sri Dushyant Sridhar, one of Mrs. Vaijpayee's favorite speakers, spontaneously accepted to deliver the lecture this year. Sri Dushyant Sridhar, in his inimitable style, has beautifully highlighted who the chosen one was and why he is considered so. If the topic of the lecture has been intriguing, the message conveyed has been illuminating, unfolding life's lessons through this chosen Shishya. My salutations to our speaker, who is a role model for the youth of today. He is passionate about science and religion, and he has effortlessly assimilated our ancient Indian wisdom. On this occasion of the Sashtip Diburthi endowment of Mrs. YGP, I would like to draw your attention to the aim of this legend. She founded the school to make every PSBBN realize the true spirit of Indianness while they have their modern education in the school. My request to all of you youngsters is, have ambitions, soar high in any field of your choice, but the runway should be the cultural roots of Bharatiyam. Best wishes to class 12 students who will be graduating in 2021. While we miss our dear Mrs. YGP today, we are sure her guiding force and her divine blessings will always be showered on all of us. Thank you, and have a good day.
Thank you, Mom. You have always been encouraging, and that has motivated us to dream big. Malvika Kannan of PSBBKK Nagar will now propose the vote of thanks.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Gratitude makes sense of our past, brings peace for today, and creates a vision for tomorrow. The annual motivational lecture is indeed an opportunity for us to be reminiscent of how lucky we are as PSBBNs to have access to stimulating talks to carve our niche path in a value-laden trail, and we indeed count our blessings and remain forever indebted. On that note, it is my honor to take this opportunity to thank, on behalf of my school, everyone who made Dr. Srimati Y.G. Rajalakshmi Parthasarathi Shashtip Diburthi Endowment Lecture 2020 an iconic experience. Dr. Mrs. Y.G. Parthasarathi, our beloved founder, is an integral part of PSBB, just like roots to a tree, and our most respectful Vandanam to her for blessing us on this occasion. I dedicate my gratitude to our endowment speaker Shri Dushyant Sridhar for accepting our invitation and embellishing this occasion with his articulate and enlightening discourse. A big thank you to our well-wishers and all associated with PSBB for being pillars of support. A special thanks to our heads of schools for spearheading every learning initiative and for the constant guidance and encouragement. Our thanks to Mr. Challa Vaidyanathan for video assistance. I dedicate my thanks to our teachers and non-teaching staff for all their support. I extend a hand of appreciation to our alumni participants and students for joining us online today with utmost enthusiasm. I clasp my hands in reverence to the Almighty for showering us with blessings and making this event momentous. Thank you.
Prayer is not only the key of the day, it is the lock of the night too. May we conclude today's program with a prayer by Tejas Venkatraman of 12C PSBB Nungambakkam.
Harihi Om Shamno Mitra Sham Varunaha Shamno Bhavat Varyamam Shamna Indro Brihaspatihi Shamno Vishnuru Rudramaha Namo Brahmane Namaste Vayo Twameva Pratyaksham Brahmasi Twameva Pratyaksham Brahma Vadishyami Ridam Vadishyami Satyam Vadishyami Tanmamavatu Tadvaktaramavatu Avatumam Avatu Vaktaram Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.
I am Sheila Prakash signing off, and I consider this a blessing to have compiled the proceedings. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha.